My name is Ken Fleece, and I'm chairman of a committee of the governor's task force called the Soldier Recognition Committee. It is one of many events that we've been doing since 2011 to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the Civil War and to keep alive the wonderful pageantry of that era, and also to keep alive the message of what the Civil War meant to this country. This particular program has been a way for us to honor all of the Civil War soldiers that served, and obviously, given the resources we have and the time and so forth, we can't individually honor the thousands of men that served in Minnesota, and those that also are buried here in Minnesota that served in other units throughout the war. So symbolically, what we've been doing over these years is rededicating the grave sites of those few soldiers that were killed, mortally wounded, or who died in prison from Minnesota that actually made it back to Minnesota. Now, there were some 825 men killed in those categories in Minnesota during the war. And today we've only found approximately 20 of those men that were brought back. And if you can understand, Minnesota was the frontier, had no railroads, no real roads, one telegraph line from Winona to St. Paul. And also when these soldiers were brought back, they were brought back typically by the efforts of their families. Families went east or went south to find the bodies of their loved ones. And so it was a very arduous, expensive procedure for those people to do so. Also, sometimes they were brought back by comrades. Many of these men, of course, had brothers and cousins, and companies all tended to be from one small area. Like Company H was from Carver County, so sometimes soldiers brought people back. And one of the things I found interestingly is many of the men that were brought back were men who had families or young wives and children, and so their fellow soldiers wished to honor them by doing that. So that's basically what we've been doing with this program. We've had some 20 events almost all over the state of Minnesota, so it was a nice way to spread the message around the state. I'd like to start by thanking everyone that is here today for coming, and also our reenactors that have so diligently come to every event. We've also had wonderful representation from local color guards. Bugler Bill has been here. And of course, we try to do these events with the assistance of a local support group, like in this case, the Carver County Historical Society, and also the Scandia Baptist Cemetery that has done a wonderful job of installing the stone and helping to pull this event together. So with that, I'd like to move forward with our program. We have a group of wonderful speakers today from the task force and also from the cemetery here to talk about various things related to Sergeant Matson and also the soldiers from Carver County and Minnesota's role in general in the Civil War. So with that, I'd like to turn the podium over to Pat Bauer. Pat's a member of the Governor's Task Force and also a member of the Events Committee of the Task Force that has been important in getting many of these and other great events we've had together. Pat?
Move this just a bit. Welcome. Thank you so much for coming here today. Most of you probably were more familiar with where this is located. As the gentleman on the golf course just said, you can't get there from here, is what he just told me. But I did, but thanks to his directions. We have the color guard here today, and I think it might be fitting if we do the pledge as long as they're here. I think that would be great. Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Well, the task force was formed several years ago by the governor to commemorate Minnesota's involvement in the Civil War. And if you go places out east, especially, people will say, Minnesota, what did they have to do with the Civil War? Well, of course, we had a great deal to do. And those of you familiar with the history know that Minnesota was the first state to offer troops to fight for the Union cause. And The task force, which is co-chaired by Representative Dean Erdahl and former Secretary of State Mark Ritchie, under their direction, we've all been doing a number of tasks over the last several years, and it's really been a wonderful experience, I think, and it's enhanced Minnesota's remembrance of all of the men and all of the people who contributed to the cause of the Civil War. And we started out in the beginning, in 2012, with many events related to the U.S.-Dakota War, and we had an event at Woodlake and a number of others as well, because that is certainly considered part of Minnesota's involvement in the Civil War. We have paired with the Minnesota Historical Society on many, many different events and speakers, exhibits, those sorts of things. If you go to the Minnesota Historical Society website, I highly suggest you that you take advantage of the recorded speeches that people have given over the years, of the short documentaries. Randall Dietrich is here, and he's one of the people who's been spearheading those things. And as a teacher, which is what I do most of the time, I really have enjoyed using those with students and think they're just a fabulous contribution to what Minnesota knows about the Civil War. Jeff Williams back here has been contributing every day with This Day in the Civil War, which is available at the Minnesota 150 website and also Facebook page. So do go on the Facebook page and like that, and you'll get a good account of what happened on each day of the Civil War. Grave dedications, rededications, such as this one, is something that Ken Fleas and Daryl Sanis have really been involved with and I think has been very important. One of the things that we would like to continue with is having a database available to people that would show all of where all of the veterans of the Civil War are buried here in the state of Minnesota. There are legacy funds, thank goodness, from the state and from the people of Minnesota that have funded many of these events and activities, and there will still be some of those funds available. So if you as an individual or you have a group that has some kind of project relating to the Civil War, contact the Minnesota 150, and those applications will be available in the beginning of the next year. Let's see. A couple of things we have done, I think, that were really extraordinary, and that was the trip to Gettysburg. Minnesota, we believe, is the only state that sent an official delegation out there to commemorate that battle 2 years ago. We also went to Nashville last fall, last November, and to be honest, until I was on the task force, I had no idea the really critical role that Minnesota played in that particular battle, which was one of the last large battles of the war, and more Minnesotans died there than at any other battle that they were involved with, and that was a really important thing. We dedicated a monument on Shies Hill there to the Minnesota soldiers. Last spring, there was a show on at the Fitzgerald Theater that was broadcast on public radio, and you can go to the Minnesota Public Radio website and listen to that streaming, but also keep an eye out in November. There will be a video, or there'll be a documentary or movie, whatever, of the of that particular show, and it was fabulous. Music and history, and it was really a wonderful event, and I think you'd enjoy watching that. So keep an eye on for TPT in November. Also in November, we will be having a commemoration of Albert Wolfson up in Duluth. And if you're familiar with Civil War history, you probably know that Albert Wolfson was the longest living Civil War veteran, died in 1956. And that will be up in Duluth on Veterans Day, which is rather fitting, I think. And the last thing I would like to do is invite everybody to come to Fort Snelling in 2 weeks. On the 15th and 16th, there will be a very large gathering of people. There will be at least 250 reenactors who will be there for that event. And I think that you'll find a lot of wonderful activities and learn a lot about what happened with Minnesotans to commemorate all of our soldiers coming back from the war. So thank you so much for coming today, and I will turn it over to the next person. Oh, I don't have one. That would be you. Thank you, Ken.
Thanks, Pat. Next, I'd like to introduce Wendy Bjorn of the Carver County Historical Society. One of the things with these programs that we've sort of insisted on is that it not just be a project of the task force, but it involve local organizations. So we've had history centers, we've had Civil War roundtables who have fronted these events for us. And one of the reasons for doing that is that we hear so much about the great battles like Nashville, Antietam, Gettysburg, Chickamauga, and so forth. People get the big picture of the history, but not so much the history sometime of the individual soldier and what they did. And we know that Carver County played a very historical role in the recruitment of soldiers for the Civil War here in Minnesota. So we look forward to Wendy telling us a little bit about that. Wendy?
Well, when I was first asked to speak, I thought, okay, my mind goes, where am I going to go with this? And I went home, and being the commensurate historian buff, I turned on the History Channel, and it happened to be a piece about World War II and the kamikaze pilots. And I thought, you know, what makes a person willing to give their life? And as I continued to think about that, I thought about some of the things that were written up by A.J. Carlson. This is a book we released last year. And in the book, Carlson mentions Matson. And I'm going to read a few things in here that I think are very pertinent to answer some of the questions of why somebody would give their life for somebody else they've never met, which is really what a lot of the people here in Minnesota did. And as I get older, I have to wear my readers. So Matson and A.J. Carlson went over to the fort, and they signed up. And as he says, as far as I have on any record or recollection at this day, the following nationalities represented the company during the 3 years were as follows: 38 Swedes, 30 Germans, 24 Americans, 11 Norwegians, 5 English, 2 French, 1 Irish, for a total of 111. For commissioned officers, we had 3 Americans, 1 German, and 1 Norwegian. And as usual, the Swedes had to take a back seat when selecting the officers, and consequently, your scribe was mustered in as a high private in the near ranks. When they came, our little squad consisted of about 20 under the command of a Sergeant Matson of Waconia, who was taken prisoner at Guntown, Mississippi, and sent to Andersonville, and stayed there from June 10th, 1864, until early in the spring of 1865, when he was exchanged and came home as a skeleton, and after having partaken of fresh fish at his home near Lake Waconia, died on the 28th May, 1865. Now the question is why in the world would they go down south? Well, I think this speaks very much of it. They had never been down south, and I would bet they had never met a person of color. So they took it on the word of somebody what was going on down there, and they volunteered before they were even U.S. citizens to go down and fight for freedoms down there. So after the battle, they were trying to get back to their troops. So they came upon a creek, and off we went in the direction indicated, and when we had done about 30 rods, we came to a little brook 15 to 20 feet wide with only one narrow plank to cross on. Having been delayed somewhat to get my drink of milk, I became rear guard at the last. On the other side of the stream stood a very old Negro, being very dark colored except for long hair, which was white as snow. Making motions for us to come across while we were crossing, he sang out to the top of his voice time and time again, "God bless you, God bless you." In stepping off the plank, I for one was the last one. I took the venerable old slave by the hand, never entertaining the thought that what I was doing was such a horrible act as afterwards that I learned. It was never tolerated during slavery times, and if ever happened, it was looked upon as the most disgraceful thing to take a hand of a slave. But at that time, for the white slave owners to have intercourse with their female slaves to such an extent that down in central Alabama and Mississippi, it was nearly impossible to find among the young generation a full-blooded Negro, but quite a number as white as their masters themselves. This was looked upon as not quite according to law, but as it had grown to be accustomed, and the white slaves brought a higher price in the open slave market, therefore it must be tolerated as a necessary evil. I noticed in leaving that the Negro had pulled the plank after us and soon struck heavy timber and was out of reach of our pursuers. For the present, traveled through the heavy woods nearly the whole night and made it about 12 miles. First-hand account from A.J. Carlson of why he fought in the Civil War. And I think that when I read that particular piece, I literally had to put it down, step back, and really wonder and be in awe at these Civil War soldiers and what they did not only for the slavery issue, but for keeping our nation together as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Wendy. Next, we'd like to talk about the 9th Minnesota itself. It seems sometimes we have a lot more familiarity with some of the regiments, Minnesota regiments, especially the 1st, which gets every bit of accolade they should because they did some tremendous heroic fighting at Antietam, Gettysburg, and other places. But few people know that the 9th Minnesota had more men, lost more men in the Civil War than any regiment in Minnesota. Much of that's dialogued in a tremendous book called One Drop in a Sea of Blue, if you get a chance to read that, written by John Lundstrom. And our next speaker, Daryl, helped review that book with John and instrumental in some facts that went into that. Daryl and his wife Diane have also been very involved in history in Anoka County and Brooklyn Park and have written a wonderful three-volume piece of work about all of the soldiers from that area. So next I'd like to welcome Daryl Sanis of the task force to tell us about Arthur Matson's regiment and company, the 9th Minnesota. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. In the summer of 1862, the Civil War had been going for a full year. President Lincoln and the other Union commanders knew at that time that the war was not going to end anytime soon. They also knew that in order to win this war, they needed many more soldiers. In July of 1862, President Lincoln called for 300,000 additional men. The Minnesota quota for that number was 5,362. Minnesota at that time had already placed men into 5 infantry regiments and would now start recruiting for 5 more, and that would be the 6th through the 10th Minnesota. Each infantry regiment was made up of roughly 1,000 men, and the enlistment period for raising these 5,000 plus men was in August of 1862. Each regiment had 10 companies, each of with about 100 men. The 10 companies that would eventually make up the 9th Minnesota included Company A from Hennepin County, Company B from Hennepin, Wright, and Carver, C from Maurer, D from Nicollet and Blue Earth, E just from Blue Earth, F from Homestead, G from Stearns, H from Carver, Company I from Scott, and finally Company K from Winona and Wabasha. The commanding officer for the 9th Minnesota was Colonel Alexander Wilkin, who had already served with the 1st and 2nd Minnesota. The lieutenant colonel or second in command was Josias Marsh, and the major was William Markham. Now, after enlisting, but before being mustered in, the Dakota War broke out in Minnesota. Minnesota Governor Ramsey would hold back all of these newly enlisted men to participate in the Dakota War. Some of the men who would be assigned to the 9th were involved directly in this Dakota War. Some of the men from Company B fought at the Battle of Acton on September 3rd, and Company C of the 9th was in the Battle of Wood Lake on September 23rd. During the fall of 1862, after the six-week Dakota War, all of the men of the 9th Minnesota were mustered in and placed at several posts in southwestern Minnesota. The men from Carver County and Company H, some of them first went to the town of Glencoe. More of them went to the town of St. Peter, and they all eventually ended up at Fort Ridgely during that winter of 62-63. Also at that time, all of the line and non-commissioned officers from all of the companies of the 9th were in St. Peter for training. Two companies, including Company H, joined the Sibley Expedition in the summer of 63 to Dakota Territory. Company H specifically went from Fort Ridgely to Camp Pope, were there for about a month, and then ended up back at Fort Ridgely. The rest of all the companies of the 9th remained at guard and post duty at several locations throughout south and western Minnesota. Finally, in September of 1863, a full year after they had enlisted, the men of the 9th were given a short furlough before heading south to fight in the Civil War. On October 8th, five of the companies boarded a steamship in St. Paul. Then in Winona, they picked up companies C, F, and K. The 9th went to Missouri, was assigned to the Army of the Cumberland, and reported to General Schofield. Through the fall of 1863 into the spring of 64, companies of the 9th were spread out in central Missouri for guard and patrol duty. In November of 1863, and what became known as the Otterville Incident, 38 men from Company C and K were held in prison for 2 months for stopping a train and freeing 11 slaves from their owner. And you can read more about that in the book that Ken mentioned on One Drop in a Sea of Blue by John Lundstrom. Then in May 26th of 1864 in St. Louis, the entire regiment was together for the very first time. 9th was sent to Memphis, Tennessee and assigned to General Sturgis, who would lead an expedition of about 8,000 men to Tupelo, Mississippi, with the purpose of finding and defeating Confederate General Nathan Bedford Forrest. At this time, Colonel Wilkin of the 9th was promoted to brigade commander, and Lieutenant Colonel Marsh took over command of the 9th. On June 10th, 1864, in the Battle of Bryce's Crossroads in northern Mississippi, Nathan Bedford Forrest attacked the Sturgis expedition, catching them strung out on muddy roads during a long march in very hot and humid conditions. In what would become known as one of the worst defeats to the Union in the Civil War, after a difficult fight, Sturgis was routed and started fleeing back to Memphis. The 9th Minnesota was one of the last regiments onto the field and therefore one of the last off. And because of that, they were ordered to perform rear guard duty. And that would allow the rest of the expedition to safely get back to Memphis. During the retreat, the tired, exhausted, and hungry men of the 9th performed admirably. But many of the men were overrun by Confederate cavalry or simply dropped in their tracks. In addition to the 8 killed and 16 wounded during the battle, 233 more were captured and sent to prisoner of war camps, including Andersonville. Later back in Memphis, what was left of the 9th was assigned to the 16th Army Corps commanded by Major General A.J. Smith. Joining the 9th were the 5th, 7th, and 10th Minnesota regiments. In July of 1864, the 9th fought in the Battle of Tupelo. The battle was a Union victory over Nathan Bedford Forrest. But during the fighting, Colonel Wilkin was killed. Alexander Wilkin was the highest ranking officer from Minnesota killed in the Civil War. Then in September of 64, the 9th and part of the 16th Corps left Memphis, Tennessee by steamship and disembarked in Duval's Bluff, Arkansas. There began the Missouri campaign as Union forces chased Confederate General Sterling Price during his raid of Missouri. The Union drove Price from Missouri, but the 9th never got close enough to take part in the fighting, which most of it was done with cavalry. During this period, the 9th traveled 772 miles by boat, 50 by rail, and 950 on foot, for a total of 1,772 miles. The 9th and the 16th Corps ended their travels in Nashville, Tennessee. They were sent there to join General Thomas and the Army of the Cumberland and to support the effort to destroy Confederate General Hood's Army of Tennessee. The 9th Minnesota, along with the 5th, 7th, and 10th, distinguished themselves in the Battle of Nashville on December 15th and 16th. Basically, on the 16th, the Minnesota regiments won the day, swept the Confederates off the field, and won the battle. After a brief winter camp in 1864-65 in Eastport, Alabama, the 9th participated in the Mobile Campaign and the taking of Spanish Fort and Fort Blakely in March of April of 1865. On April 13th, the 9th headed north from Mobile for Montgomery, Alabama. But then on April 19th, as they were heading north, 10 days after the event, the 9th heard of Lee's surrender at Appomattox Courthouse. After a short celebration of the end of the war, the 9th was sent to an area near Selma, Alabama, for occupation duty. And then in July, their duty for the Union finally over, they headed home, arriving in St. Paul on August 11th. They were welcomed home, received furloughs, and then reported back to Fort Snelling, and were formally mustered out on August 24th, 1865. For the 9th Minnesota, 1,076 men were listed on the regimental roster. Only 402 were present when they mustered out. 263 were dead. Of the five infantry regiments that enlisted in the summer of 62, the 9th had the most fatalities and the most combat-related deaths. The 9th had the most men of all Minnesota regiments or unions that died in prison camps. A total of 139 men of the 9th died in prison camps or shortly after their release. I will end there. Thank you.
Thanks, Daryl. Next, we'd like to talk about prisoners of war and prison camps. And as Daryl mentioned, when you look at Minnesota, states like New York had 390-some units in the Civil War. Illinois had 274. Pennsylvania had 245 units. Minnesota only had 20 units in the war, but yet Minnesota and the 9th Minnesota ranks at number 14th on the list of soldiers that died in prison during the Civil War. Also, the 9th Minnesota, I would mention, if you look at all of the units that fought in the Western Theater of the Civil War, Minnesota ranks number one in the number of men that died in prison camp. So next, we'd like to explore this issue, and our speaker for that is Jeff Williams. As Pat mentioned earlier, Jeff's a member of the task force and has done an incredible, unbelievable job of publishing a long series every week of the Civil War for the last 4 or 5 years in papers throughout the state, and I know a lot of people that have read them and have appreciated them very much. Jeff is a Iraq War veteran, and as I mentioned, a task force member. He's a published author, and I believe Jeff is still working on his master's degree in history. And he was also the co-chairman of the Political Action Committee, Minnesota Won't Forget Their POWs and MIA. Jeff Williams.
Thank you, Ken. I have to start my remarks by saying what a tremendous honor it is to be here to pay tribute to Sergeant Matson. As I begin with my remarks today, I want to start off by a definition of one word. Now, one word is parole. We hear the word parole even today in the current jurisprudence system. A prisoner is out on parole. But where did that term come from? What does it really mean? Parole is really a European concept. It is based upon the personal honor of the prisoner and the good faith of warring nations, and has a tradition that means that the militaries handle and how they captured their enemy officers. A prisoner gave a pledge that he would not attempt to escape or fight against his captors if he was allowed to wait for his exchange, either at a designated area in enemy territory or back in his home country. Anyone who violated his word or his parole would no longer be considered a gentleman and could be executed if recaptured. That's the origin of parole. That system was in place from 1607 through 1860 as America, from our colonial era up through the Civil War, had utilized paroles in all of its wars. I'm going to separate this because that is the tradition leading into the Civil War. Yes, there were paroles in the Civil War, which is what I'm going to get into. In 1861, neither side, North nor South, they were prepared to handle mass prisoners of war because both sides felt that the war was going to be very short. Commanders in the field often created an informal parole system, as it was difficult to feed, house, and transport prisoners, and it would drain the limited resources that were available to the army at hand. For the Confederacy, thousands of federal prisoners were captured after First Bull Run, Shiloh, and the 7 Days Campaign. Believing that the Confederates were abusing federal prisoners, pressure came from the northern media and from the citizenry at large to obtain the release of federal prisoners from the South. At the time, the Lincoln administration did not want to do this because they felt that that would create acknowledgement for a nation of the Confederate States of America, which is why they were opposed. But with relenting pressure, first came General Order 100, known as the Lieber Code, and that was named for Francis Lieber, who Lincoln appointed with the task of drafting a code of conduct for the warring parties. And it was modeled after a similar agreement between the United States and the British during the War of 1812. The Lieber Code spelled out such provisions regarding the care of prisoners, granting and acceptance of paroles, and what kinds of services or work that prisoners could do for their governments while waiting for exchange. By 1862, Federal Major General John Dix, who Fort Dix, New Jersey is named after, and Confederate General Daniel Harvey Hill had reached an agreement on July 22, 1862, and that codified the procedures for prisoner exchange. Privates were exchanged one for one, but there was a sliding scale. An NCO, non-commissioned officer, corporal, sergeant, one NCO was equal to two privates. A second lieutenant had the value of three privates. So on and so forth until the exchange for a commanding general was equal to 60 privates. The Dix Hill cartel, as it was called, also had a provision that prisoners were to be paroled within 10 days of capture and at agreed upon locations, usually City Point, Virginia, or Vicksburg, Mississippi. And then any surplus parolees were returned to federal control and held in parole camps. However, you would think that a parole camp in federal lines for federal prisoners would be kind of like a country club, almost like the golf course across the street. But they were as bad, if not worse, than the Confederate prison camps that they served in. Confederate prisons were established under the leadership of General John Winder, and were established throughout the South, including Libby Prison in Richmond, Virginia, which was from an old converted tobacco warehouse, at Belle Isle, outside of Richmond, at Salisbury, North Carolina, in Macon, Georgia, and, of course, in rural Georgia at a place called Andersonville. federal presence fell under the jurisdiction of Colonel William Huffman, and he opened and expanded prison camps in such places as Camp Douglas, Illinois, Elmira, New York, Camp Morton in Indianapolis, Indiana, Point Lookout, Maryland, Rock Island, Illinois, and on Johnson's Island, Sandusky, Ohio. And Johnson's Island was a Confederate officer's prisoner of war camp. Prisoner exchanges under the Dix-Hill Cartel were very short-lived. After Lincoln had released the Emancipation Proclamation in September of 1862, and then allowed for the raising of U.S. colored troop regiments, the Confederate government had announced that they would execute white officers who were found leading those USCT regiments, and they would turn any captured black soldiers over to states to be treated as rebellious slaves. Prisoner exchanges were then halted. Yet with the battles in 1863 and 1864, in places like Chancellorsville, Gettysburg, Vicksburg, Petersburg, Nashville, and Franklin, the prison population, especially in the South, swelled. And the South was already struggling by that point just to keep their own army with supplies and provisions, and they could scarce afford to house thousands more federal prisoners. By war's end, about 144,000 federal soldiers were held prisoner. About 30,000 died in captivity. Approximately 215,000 Confederates were taken prisoner, and 26,000 died in captivity. Andersonville was established in January 1864, and in 16 and a half acres, it was built to house 10,000 federal prisoners of war. In its original design, it was supposed to be state, what we would call state-of-the-art. It was supposed to be an area of more humanitarian efforts. There was a stream coming through the camp in order to provide fresh water. They were trying to build, or supposed to build, barracks. Unfortunately, there was a shortage of nails. They never got built. Another problem that occurred at Andersonville was that the bakery was located upstream, and all of the bakery's refuse was thrown into the stream and was brought into the prison camp. Then came the overcrowding. By August 1864, that 10,000-sized prison camp on 16 and a half acres swelled to 33,000 people. And if you look in your program, there's a picture, an artist's depiction of that compound. And 16 and a half acres doesn't look to be too big. But for 3.5 acres, it was a swamp. And when you have, you know, bad drinking water and so many people, that's when you start getting diseases. And a lot of the prisoners who came into Andersonville already had suppressed immune systems because they were already sick and diseased. By December 1864, only 1,359 prisoners who were too sick to move to other prisons had remained behind at Andersonville. Just under 13,000 total had died and were buried in the camp cemetery, which is part of the Andersonville National Park, National Cemetery, and home of the National Prisoner of War Missing in Action Museum. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. Next, that kind of concludes our overall summary of the 9th Minnesota and the Civil War and the prison system. And now we'd like to focus on the individual soldier, such as Andrew Matson here. And like they said, many were not fortunate enough to make it home. Some around the country, like Sergeant Matson, barely made it home and then passed away. So we'd like to hear more about Sergeant Matson. So Karen Bach, who's the director of the cemetery here at Scandia, is going to give us a little background on Sergeant Matson. Karen?
Thank you, Ken. My great-great-grandfather, Peter Daniel Anderson, is also a Civil War veteran. He is buried in this cemetery as well. And so when it comes to Civil War stories, our family has a couple of their own. But Andrew Matson was an early settler in Carver County. He homesteaded on the northeast shore of Lake Waconia, which is to my left. And he was a member of the Scandia Baptist Church, a church that was founded by Swedish immigrants coming out here for free land. Scandia Baptist Church was established in 1855, before the state of Minnesota was a state. Andrew Matson joined the Army in August 22, 1862, at the age of 29. And he served as a sergeant over a squad of 20 men. Although Company H of the 9th Regiment was originally organized to fight in the Civil War, they first fought against the Indians in the Dakota War, as you have previously heard. Sergeant Matson witnessed the mass execution of Indians in Mankato. Then they traveled south to Mississippi to rejoin the rest of the 9th Regiment in the fall of 1863. As you've heard, Sergeant Matson was captured June 10, 1864, in the Battle of Guntown, Mississippi, and held as a prisoner in Andersonville. At the end of the war, he returned to Minnesota, where he died on May 28, 1865. He is buried here in the Scandia Baptist Cemetery in a casket that was made by Andrew Peterson, who also was an immigrant from Sweden coming to this wonderful land and creating what we now know as Waconia. Just 4 months later, Andrew Matson's son died, and again, Andrew Peterson made that casket. We believe Andrew Matson's son is most likely buried next to his father in an unmarked grave. This information comes to you from the Andrew Peterson and Scandia Story book that was put together by Josephine Mihalik, and also the book Two Wars of the Frontier, The Diaries of A.J. Carlson. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the Carver County Historical Society and the Civil War Task Force for their involvement in making this day possible. But I also would like to give honor and thanks to the Island View Golf Course that this cemetery is now surrounded by. I believe you can probably say that this is the only cemetery surrounded by a golf course in the state of Minnesota. We thank Island View Golf Course for their hospitality, for their neighborliness, and kindness toward us. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen. With that, we'd like to begin the dedication part of our ceremony. Of the 20 soldiers or so that we found that were returned for burial in Minnesota, we have gotten new markers for something like 15 of those who had markers either in very disheveled state or, in some cases, if you can believe that, some of these very honored men who were killed in battle and whose families went to a tremendous effort to bring them back have not even had a stone of any sort. And so part of our mission has been to get them new granite stones that will last forever, or even in the case of Sergeant Matson, with a stone that's still in fairly good shape, a stone that as people visited, if you notice, all the Civil War stones have a similar symbol on them, and it generally just has the man's name, his birth, maybe death date, his regiment, and his company, and doesn't say anything about the honored status of him being a KIA in the war. So we mention that on the stone of these particular men. With that, we'd like to start this ceremony with the VFW from Waconia is going to perform a missing soldier routine. Gentlemen.
At this time, I would read our missing man roll call and prayer. Our sympathy to the family and friends of Andrew Matson from the VFW Post 5462 in Laconia. We are assembled here to pay our last tribute of respect to our departed comrade. When the call of our country was heard, Sergeant Matson answered. He forgot about himself for a cause of greater good. As a brave man, he marched away with faith in his God, his country, and his flag. The red of our country's flag was made redder by his heroism. The white more pure by the motives that impelled him. And in the field stars of our nation's flag, the blue has been glorified by the service he has given for American ideals. O God, Father of us all, we hereby extend these final earthly tributes to our beloved comrade. Accept our prayers in behalf of the servant departed. Welcome him to thy house to rest in peace. Have mercy upon the loved one who greatly has passed. Comfort and console them through thine own tenderness. These things we ask in thy name. Again, we extend our sympathy to family and friends, and with that we will proceed to the final roll call. Gentlemen, Ralph Lavarce.
Here.
Paul Burt.
Here.
Roger Pavlik.
Here.
Donald Denial.
Here.
Andrew Matson. Andrew Matson. Sergeant Matson is at this time unable to respond. Roger Lorkey.
Here.
Ron Brunt.
Here.
Steve Model.
Here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'd like now to proceed with a ceremony that has been adopted from a ceremony that was done by the GAR over many years in the 1880s and beyond. The government started making available to veterans markers, and when those markers were installed, veterans came to the cemetery. They many times had picnics or other kinds of family gatherings in the cemetery, and had other soldiers come and perform a ceremony that dedicated that particular new stone. So with that, I'd like to invite Commander Arne Kine forward for the dedication ceremony. Arne?
Camp, attention! Squad, raise, hold! Parade, rest! May we, as we stand here by this grave, remember that it is our duty to honor the memory of the men who stood shoulder to shoulder on the fields of battle and who so faithfully guarded the bonds of statehood and who fought for liberty. May we not forget them through the passing years. As we remember Sergeant Andrew Matson, let us cherish his example as a patriot and defender of those principles he believed to be right. Let us not forget his sacrifice or that of all the brave soldiers who have given their lives in the cause of freedom.
On behalf of a grateful nation, I give this tribute
a symbol of an undying love for the comrades of war.
As a symbol of purity, we offer at this lowly grave a rose. May future generations emulate the unselfish devotion of even the least of our heroes.
As a last token of our affection, we crown these remains with the symbol of victory. On behalf of the nation for whose integrity and unity our late comrade, Sergeant Andrew Matson, offered his life during the Civil War, I deposit this flag. About face.
squad, ready! Aim! Fire! Shoulder! Hold! Hello! Face! Present! Hold! Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our ceremony. We thank you for your courtesy and your participation and for coming today.
If one were to take a look at the Prisoner of War Missing in Action flag today, one sentence usually comes underneath the flag, and that is, "We will never forget." And in this case, here today, we remembered Sergeant Andrew Matson, who was a prisoner of war at Andersonville. And even though he died 150 years ago, he still is not forgotten. And I think that's one of the great things that makes our country really great, is that we don't forget, that we do take the time out of our days, even on not a holiday, but just on a regular weekend day, we come out and we rededicate gravestones. We remember veterans because they're the ones who made this country what it is. So for North Star Oasis, Jeff Williams. Thanks for watching.